The day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. I am so excited to be here with Pastor Brian Jenkins from Chosen 300. I have followed you for a number of years, and I'm just so excited to sit down and talk with you just about your ministry and your organization. How are you this afternoon?
I'm glad to be here, and thank you so much for inviting me on your show. And I look forward to sharing with your folks today.
Amen. Amen. So before we get started, we always go into prayer. We want to acknowledge the Lord before we do anything. So let's just bow our heads for a word of prayer.
Amen.
Father God, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you're doing in our lives, oh God. God, we just ask that you be in the midst of us, oh God. Even in this interview, your word tells us that when two or three are gathered together, you are in the midst. And we thank you so much, oh God. We ask you to just guide our conversation, oh God. Let somebody's heart be pricked. Let somebody be encouraged, oh God. In the name of Jesus, for this interview, let somebody know that they can make it and that with you, all things are possible. We give you all glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So tell us a little bit about yourself.
So I was actually born here in Philadelphia in a place called Tasker Projects. Now they have the Tasker Homes where they have $400,000 condos. but back then it was indeed the projects. My mother was Caucasian. My father was, I think he was black because I came out this way somehow. there is a going joke that he was the maintenance man at the projects where my mom lived. So apparently he was working on more than just the pipes. And so that's a joke that kind of goes along with me. But at any rate, my mom died when I was 5 years old. And I actually wound up in an orphanage here in Philadelphia called Stenton Child Center. We used to be at the corner of Belfield and Stenton. And from there, I went into foster care. There was a wonderful family, Teresa and Willie Jemison. They took me into their home. And I was the youngest of 25 foster children. Mm-hmm. And I think through that experience in my life, it kind of taught me how to share with others and to extend kindness. I went to Temple University. At my background was human resources. I was also insurance agent in 37 states across the country. I was a member of the National Association of Securities Dealers. I advised the top leaders council, Million Dollar Roundtable, mutual funds and annuities, and that was my career. I was also a Baptist minister, a very traditional Baptist church, the Zion Baptist Church of Ardmore. Had a long black robe with two crosses on the side. So that's the makeup of who I am. I have two wonderful sons, David and Jonathan. They're 19 now, just graduated from high school. So looking forward for them taking their next step in life.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. So how long has your organization, Chosen 300, been in existence?
Well, we started in 1996, and it really was not intended. It was something that happened out of God just shifting a period in my life. It was 1996. I had just come back to Philadelphia, had went away for a while, and moved out to Reading, Pennsylvania, and came back to Philadelphia. And I was at a play at the Miriam Theater, and there was a homeless man standing outside of that play. And he was obviously homeless. He had some stained pants that lifted above his ankles. He had a half-torn blanket that wrapped around him that exposed his meatless ribs. And he had a rope that he tied around his waist to hold up his pants. An amazing thing that night is that all the Christians that were at this play saw this homeless man and walked right by. And they were members of our congregation, your congregation, congregations all over the city. They saw the Christian play, but they didn't have the compassion in their hearts to really reach out to this man that was standing outside of the play. And my heart was touched with compassion, not because of who I am, but because of the Christ in them, in me. And I shared with him the last 40 cents I had, and I said, I wish I could do more for you. And his reply was, but you considered me. Mm-hmm. And it's like someone took a knife and stuck it in my chest and turned it and said, are you really helping the poor to the capacity that you're able to? And my real answer was no. And so he asked for a Bible that night, and I didn't have one to give him. I said, tell me where you're going to be next week, and I'll bring you a Bible and something to eat. And I met him on the corner where he said he would be the next week, and I packed 40 bag lunches and gave him a Bible and gave him that lunch I told him I would give him. And the amazing thing is that I never saw this man again. Now, when I look at this man, he had the imagery of what Christ would look like, not that picture where, you know, had a, one little drop of blood coming down on the side, and you had a guy stacked with, you know, pecs and, you know, built with a six pack. That's not what Jesus has looked like. That's what, you know, a lot of ladies put up on their wall. But in Isaiah, it says that he has no comeliness that we should desire him, that he looks like a root out of dry ground. And that man looked like a root out of dry ground, and he looked like the imagery of what Christ was. And I never seen him again. And there's a scripture in Hebrews 13 that says, be careful how you treat strangers, because you may be entertaining an angel unaware. And that was my angel that night that thrust us into mission. And so we walked through Center City, Philadelphia, passing out these bag lunches, and I came to 16th and the Benjamin Franklin Parkway. There were 10 homeless men there. I had 5 bag lunches left, and I began to divide them among themselves. Mm-hmm. And it taught me something that night, is that this is not what the media portrayed, that people are dangerous that are homeless, or they'll try to hurt you, they'll try to take advantage of you. What I saw that night was a community of people that were down on their luck, that needed help, but were willing to take a sandwich and divide it so everybody in their community could eat. And so that was the spark of Chosen 300 that night on Father's Day in 1996 and that first Tuesday afterwards.
Wow, that is beautiful. That's a beautiful testimony. So what made you call it Chosen 300? Is it symbolic? Is the name symbolic of something?
Yeah, absolutely. So it kind of goes back to 1995, a year before that. There's a service that we had. It was called Gideon 300. It was based upon the theme of Judges 6 and 7, where Gideon chose 300 men to fight against the Midianites. Mm-hmm. Now, ironically, our name used to be Gideon 300 until there was an organization that decided that they want to challenge us on the name. And so we had to change the name. And so it kind of worked out. Because Chosen 300, it says a lot. One, it's about winning the impossible war against hunger, but also it shows that this is not something that we do just out of our Christianity, but also out of our humanity, because there's a lot of people that come to volunteer and serve at Chosen 300. They're Muslims, they're Mormons, they're Jewish people, they're from every different race, denomination, background, and this is the welcome place where anybody can come. Now, we're not going to compromise who we are. We do this out of our Christian conviction, but it is the place where anybody can come and serve. So Chosen 300 has created a neutral name where, okay, we can be the pastor and the church for the people that we serve. We can be the parachurch ministry for churches that want to be part of a wonderful organization. We can be the nonprofit 501c3 nonprofit organization that charities and corporations want to give to. So it's a wonderful name that really states what we do and allows us to be able to have impact on those that need, but also welcome anybody to come and serve.
That's beautiful. And you touched on one of my questions. I wanted to know, you know, how do you deal with stakeholders who are not Christian?
Well, we let them know clearly is that, you know, we do this out of our Christian conviction, but we need your help. And this is part, all of us have our humanity. And the word humanity means to be humane. Mm-hmm. And so regardless of what faith you are, what walk of life you are, in your humanity should be the desire that God has placed in you, whatever you identify God as. Mm-hmm. God has placed in you a desire to be needed of someone else and to extend kindness and love to others. No matter what faith you are in, when you talk about the Jewish faith, you have Isaiah 58. It says that we should be restore the breach and restore the paths to dwell in. You deal with the Quran. There's scripture in the Quran that tells us about extending kindness to the poor. Mm-hmm. So no matter what faith you're part of it, all of it, every faith has a component about extending kindness. So we might not agree on everything, but one thing we can have a commonality in is that there are people that are hungry, there are people that are hurting and that need hope, and then also need a hand to get up.
Amen. That's beautiful. So volunteering, I have volunteered at Chosen 300 in Spring Garden when I was in college. I went to Temple as well.
to you.
And then when you guys moved here, I volunteered here several times. And it's a unique experience, right? It's not just you come in, get your food, and you leave, or you're just passing out bags. It's a different experience. So could you just describe a day in the life of a volunteer at Chosen 300?
Well, one thing that you tuned in on is that it is an experience. It's not just coming to throw food on people's plate. Mm-hmm. I always let people know that this is not a soup kitchen. This is a fine dining establishment for people that are impoverished, so that way they can come in and have a wonderful place to dine. Mm-hmm. But then part of that there's the worship component.
Yes.
That's critical, because every time that we gather, every time we serve a meal, we believe that it is our responsibility to give hope. And we believe the avenue of hope is through the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so we share the gospel, we have worship, we have song, and then after which we serve the meal. We serve them intentionally in a restaurant style. They don't have to get up and get behind that Nazi soup kitchen and there's some soup on your plate.
Right.
But no, they actually are served because we want them to have a wonderful dining experience, that I should be able to sit down at the table and have that same meal and feel good about it. And that's the kind of meal that I want them to have. They have to have that meat, two starches, vegetable salad, bread, dessert. Grandmom's Thanksgiving, six days a week. And so that's what we do, just provide an outstanding meal, outstanding service. But then also part of the volunteer experience is that after the service is over, we cleaned up, we gather together in a circle. We talk about our experience, and I've seen so many different reactions. Some people walk away mad, says, I'm really upset at poverty. Mm-hmm. Some people walk away crying that it's really impacted them. Some people walk away happy and joyful, says, wow, this is the best thing since sliced bread. I got to do this again.
Mm-hmm.
And so all of us have different reactions. And so that's part of the volunteer experience, is that one, that not only that you're coming to help somebody, but that experience will be able to impact you to say, what can I do more to help people that are impoverished, that are homeless, that are dealing with food insufficiency?
That's beautiful. And one thing, and I've never told you this, one thing I do admire about you, because like you said, because I've eaten here, right? So it's not just, here's a sandwich, you're homeless or you don't have it. Here's something, at least I gave you something. The meals that you all provide is something that anybody can eat, anybody will feel comfortable eating. And I've seen you get upset about a meal that wasn't sufficient.
Yeah.
And it touched my heart, because it's like, you're not just trying to do something just to be seen. Like, you were genuinely upset that this meal was not, you know, up to par.
I'm a big bulldog about food. And like I said, if I'm not willing and able to sit down and eat and enjoy it, or there's not enough for me to be able to sit down and enjoy it, that means that there wasn't enough food for all the guests, because I'm going to be the last person that's going to eat.
Right.
But I'm going to sit down at the table and have fellowship with them. But it's important to be able to provide, one, a quality meal, but also a quantitative meal that's going to fill their stomachs, provide some just nourishment, but also give them some joy and gladness that they came to a wonderful place today.
Yes. Yes, and you do just that. So I know that you serve meals Sunday, Monday, Wednesdays, Fridays to at least, 100. I know you have to have at least 150 meals when people come to volunteer. So where do you find those dedicated individuals to actually provide these meals throughout the week? Because it's a lot. Food is expensive. People don't want to help all the time.
Absolutely. And it's a principle about maximizing effort and minimizing costs. And so we serve 6 days a week. We actually have three locations, Center City, West Philadelphia, and Pottstown. So Center City is 6 days a week. It's 3 days a week here, and it's 2 days a week in Pottstown. And then we have some bulk food distributions that we do throughout the year. Like, for instance, in Ambler, Pennsylvania, we serve the seniors where they come and drive through. And we have different pop-up sites where we provide food. We'll do dinner for seniors, like in Reading, Pennsylvania. So we have a lot going on all the time. But it's through collaboration, and that's the key. So there are now 118 churches that are part of the Chosen 300 Network, and they're not just churches. There's churches, there's synagogues, there's companies, there's hospitals. And so what happens is that each church or each group comes down once a month or once every other month. They provide the meal, and if they're a Christian organization, we allow them to do the worship service because we want to keep everything on the same playing field, that we're always sharing the gospel. So if you're a Muslim group, you can still come serve, but we're not going to have you lead the worship that night. It's funny because there was years ago, there was a certain religion, I won't say the name of the religion, asked me, could they come and serve, but could they also lead the worship? And they were not in line with our faith. And so the Lord really had to kind of direct me how to answer that. And I said to them, I says, I would be glad to have you lead the worship, but if you don't mind, could I come speak at your temple first? And that kind of shut the whole thing down because of the fact that then they had to understand, well, no, you can't, because not only can I speak in your temple, I can't even walk in your temple. Mm. And so I'm going to welcome you to come. But what we do here
right.
is that we share the gospel of Jesus Christ and give them hope through that avenue. And we welcome you as long as you can work with us. We're happy that you came and we're glad that you served. But there is a line that we're not going to cross, that the gospel of Jesus Christ is the light and power unto salvation. And that's what we want to offer people. But the churches, they're again, the groups that come, they're responsible for purchasing the food, preparing it and bringing it in. Now, during the course of the month, we might have 10 to 15 slots mm-hmm. that are not filled with churches or groups. So then we are then responsible for purchasing the food, preparing it and bringing it in. So out of the about, I guess, say $350,000 worth of food that we put out, we mm-hmm. still have to spend about $100,000 on the meals that are for slots that are not filled. And then on top of that, all of the bulk distributions and things like that, a lot of times we have to buy the produce, mm-hmm. but we might get a shipment of food from a certain organization like Fill Abundance or Share mm-hmm. or something like that. So we try to supplement things based upon what we receive. Today we got donations of certain desserts and items and things like that. So we make it work. But again, it's maximizing effort, minimizing costs, so that way we can provide excellent quality service. But also it gives churches the ability to be able to do missions on the level that they mm-hmm. can afford without having to reinvent the wheel. When a church tries to serve every day or every week, mm-hmm. it can overtax them both financially and as far as the human resources. But here they can come to a place and walk alongside of other churches and be able to have a powerful impact together. And that's what it's about. The beautiful thing is that it involves different races, different denominations.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And the theme of our ministry from the beginning has been uniting the body of Christ to reach the world. And so we take the body and say, listen, yeah, you might baptize in the name of Jesus. You might baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You might sprinkle, you might dunk. You might do it at birth, you might do it later on. Okay, all of us have some commonality, it's Jesus. Mm-hmm. And even if you don't have a commonality of Jesus, okay, you have a commonality that you can provide food to people.
Right.
And so that's how we operate, is by bringing people together, regardless of their faith, their backgrounds, their churches, their denominations, their race, their ethnic group. They can come to a place called Chosen 300 to work together to carry out the kingdom work of Jesus.
That's beautiful. That is beautiful. And I've definitely, seen different races and different, just different people. And it's just beautiful how everybody comes together, works together. We serve together. We clean up together. We talk to the community, and it's beautiful. Another thing that you do that's admirable is you just don't minister to the person's hunger, but you also... We talked about the spirituality, but also the whole person, right? So you have the free haircut days and the spa days, and you give vaccines and just all those different things. So could you just touch on that?
Sure. Well, there's no saying that you can give a man a fish, he can eat for a day. But if you teach a man a fish, he can eat for a lifetime. And so we provide as many services as possible that can move people towards self-sufficiency. Mm-hmm. And so you mentioned a couple things. I'll give you an example, the barbershop. The barbershop is intentional because, one, when a person gets their haircut, and I need one now, I need to shave. So sorry that I didn't shave y'all. But anyway, but when a person gets their haircut, it transforms them mm-hmm. And gives them a sense of self-esteem, and they can walk out the door with their head up high. We have salon days, and salon days are amazing because you'll see a woman come in, tore up from the floor up.
Right.
But when they walk out, we're like, wow. I mean, it's like the transformation that occurs. But then they can also go out and say, okay, I can go on a job interview now mm-hmm. and look presentable and have a better opportunity to be able to land that job or move forward. And so that's critical. We have expungement services where if a person has a record, whether it's an ARD, whether it's an old arrest or a misdemeanor, they can come here, meet with an attorney. They take care of all the fees. We clear their record. And
wow.
So that way they can go out and land a job. Now, some people we can't help if they have felonies.
Right.
I mean, you murdered somebody. We might not be able to help
right.
this fast.
Right.
We'll do our best. But, there's a lot of things that can be cleared. There was a lady one time, 72 years old, came to us. And she was actually a volunteer. She wasn't even a guest. She had worked for the school district of Philadelphia for 35 years. She retired, chilled out for 6 months, went to go work for a temp agency to work back at the same school that she had worked at, and was denied the job because of a larceny charge in 1971 over an uncooked egg because she refused to pay for the egg.
Oh, wow.
And so we were able to get her record clean, and grandma was able to go work and was back in the school cafeteria. And so it was just, you know, and that was just one of those amazing experiences. So, but then we have the health clinics, you know, making sure people stay healthy, doing blood pressure checks, providing resume writing classes, doing job fairs. All those things are so vitally important. Say, how can we help you get to the next step? We have a campus pastors here who also work as case managers, where they can come and meet with them and say, okay, all right, what is the next step? Maybe your next step is, I just need to get my driver's license, or I need to get my ID back.
Wow.
It's whatever is success for them. You know, a lot of times we paint success as we got to have the 3-bedroom house with the white picket fence in the suburbs. For them, success might be a room with a shared bathroom.
Wow.
But it's helping them to get to that next step. And that's what this is all about. Not just giving them food, but giving them the hope and the direction and the tools to be able to move towards self-sufficiency.
That's beautiful. That is beautiful. So we've heard of many achievements that you all have, but what would you say is the greatest achievement that your organization has?
I think the just the continued growth of the organization. We have been able in 26 years to purchase 2 separate properties, gut them, renovate them, pay them off, have a third one that we lease the space out. To have a global operation in 24 locations around the world in 11 countries, to be able to build wells, to do agriculture development, to have orphanages, and to be able to impact people's lives. And we did it all by the grace of God.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of times people ask, well, how do we do it? Mm-hmm. It's through the power of Jesus Christ. I mean, he gets all the glory because he opens doors that no man can close. And people have tried to close doors on us. But God has kept us. And I think one of the great success stories that I love to share about 2012, the city of Philadelphia tried to ban outdoor meals to the homeless.
Mm.
That was one of our greatest successes, to be able to take them all the way to federal court and to beat them.
Wow.
And God not only gave us the strength to do it, but gave us the resources where he allowed the ACLU to come in and actually back the case where we didn't have to pay a dime for it.
Mm-hmm.
And so to be able to stand up for against injustice, to be able to provide food to people, to give people hope for the journey. That's what success is. When someone comes and shakes their keys and says, I got my apartment today.
Wow.
That's the success. When somebody says, you know what, I've been clean for 8 months. That's the success. And so those are the things that, you know, that excites us and that motivates us every time that we're able to conquer something else. We just bought another property in the back here in West Philadelphia, and the goal was to build a subsidized housing. That's going to be a huge project, and it's taking that next step to make it happen. So making sure that the ministry continues to grow, we're continuing to be an impact, and we not only sustain ourselves, but continue to increase capacity.
Wow. So I just want to back up a little bit. When you started out, who was on your team? How many people?
I had a couple people that were on our team that you know, helped us out and helped us move the ministry forward. And I actually used to cook food in my 1-bedroom apartment.
Wow.
And had corn and sodas going up the walls. I used to time the oven in the kitchen while I was at Prudential Investments and time it to come on at a certain time, run home for lunch, check the chicken, and then put it back in the oven. And then run back, go back on my next break and turn the oven off, put it in the back of my car. And when I got home and ran and did a circle, I actually had a 1994 Toyota Corolla that I used to pack all the food in, mm-hmm. that I later had to rip the interior out the trunk because chicken juice fell through all the car. The seat started to grow stuff on it. I had to have it upholstered.
Mm-hmm.
And it's funny because the first computer that I bought for the ministry was a compact Presario in 1996. With 2 gigabytes of hard drive space.
Oh,
it was $2,000.
Wow.
But how I bought that computer was that there was an old lady across the street slammed in the back of my Toyota Corolla and put a dent, you know, all the way down the side of it. And I got the insurance check, and the Lord said, go buy the computer for the ministry. I said, well, what about the car? He says, you gave that car to me. You said I could use it for whatever I want.
Wow.
And I'll never tell God that he can have my cars anymore. because honestly, he took me seriously. And I took that, and I rode around with that dent in the side of my car for 3 years.
Yeah.
Chicken juice now spilt in through the car. Food stains all over the car. And finally, when I got it to about 185,000 miles, I took the car and donated it to a family whose the husband had just died. It was a single mother with four kids. And that was the use of my car. And I remember I brought that car brand new, brand spanking new, 1994 Toyota Corolla. And I said, God, thank you for my car. God, use it for your glory. And he took it literally. So I never told him again, you can have my car.
Wow. Wow. So you started out with just you and maybe a small team. What does your team look like now?
So now we have seven employees.
Okay.
There are three of us that are full-time, four that are part-time. But then we have about 2,100 volunteers. There's about 118 churches, so each church has a team leader that is over it. Our international partners around the world, each site has a team leader that is responsible for the food distributions in multiple locations. So it's an organism,
mm-hmm.
And it continues to grow. It's there's a book, and I forgot the author, but it's called Having a Contagious Vision.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe that our vision that God has given us is contagious, that it is hard to come here and volunteer and serve and walk out and say, well, I need to do this again. And people tell somebody else to tell somebody else to tell somebody else. And it says, this is the best thing since sliced bread. You got to go to Chosen 300. And I tell people all the time, if you come to Philadelphia, there's three things that you have to do. You got to get a cheesesteak. You got to go get a water ice. And you got to come to Chosen 300.
Wow. So with all of that, I kind of want to deviate a little bit and talk about leadership.
Mm-hmm.
Because we know leadership is important. If you don't have people following you, then John Maxwell said you're just taking a walk. If you don't
Absolutely.
Have people following you. So, and I know that it's not always peachy keen. You know, you don't always have everybody agreeing with you. You don't always have everybody supporting you. So how do you deal with people?
I think it's doing ministry as a team. And one of the things that you'll find about me is that I know that in the beginning you called me Pastor Brian Jenkins, and although I am the senior pastor of the church, you'll never have me call myself that.
Yeah.
That one, I think it's essential in leadership to walk around in humility.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the things that I try to lead with is with humility and grace. Now I got to do my job and I have to give directives sometimes, mm-hmm. But on the same token, it's also getting the input of the team and saying, okay, what are your suggestions? How can you contribute? And one of the things that the staff has been able to do here is that bring an idea. What is your idea? How can you make Chosen 300 better? When we hire people, we want to find out, okay, not only what can you do that we can tell you to do, what can you bring to the table to make Chosen 300 greater?
Mm-hmm.
And so that's important, just having folks that do support you. But I think one of the things that is awesome about this organization, I can say for a surety that everyone here does it because they really love the work of Jesus. I mean, because it's not because of the pay. I always tell people it's the benefits are out of this world. It is the intrinsic reward that, you know, that God gives us. And I think also they see the sacrifice of leadership, because if you as a leader are sacrificing, they're also willing to sacrifice and give of themselves. And everyone here works hard. They work diligently and they try to make Chosen 300 a great place. You know, things happen, you know, people come and they go. I think we have a real good, strong team now. And, you know, and I think there's going to be additional people that come along the way. It's part of doing any ministry is that you'll find that in order to be effective, you have to have a team that works together, because there is no I in team. But if we work together, we can impact people's lives for change.
All right. So you have now three locations.
Regionally.
Regionally. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. You have three locations regionally.
Okay.
So I wanted to, where do you see Chosen 300 going in the next year, the next 5 years, the next 10 years? What is your vision?
Well, I think our number one goal in the next year to two, in particular, is to build a subsidized housing unit. It does a couple things. One, and I'll be transparent with you, is that ministry is also a business. Mm-hmm. It's God's business. There's a scripture in the book of Acts, and it says that when he called the seven, that we needed men that were full of the Holy Spirit, full of wisdom, and whom we could anoint over this business. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people think that, oh, no, church isn't a business. Ministry is not a business. It's God's work. It is God's work. It's God's business, though. Mm-hmm. And so we have to be smart and strategic on how we do things. And so one of the reasons why we wanted to do subsidized housing is because of the fact that it will provide a continual revenue for the organization. Mm-hmm. It also will help people that may have been going into homelessness, prevent them from entering the homelessness, and the people that are ready for the next step for permanent housing can come out of homelessness and start moving towards a life of self-sufficiency and permanency. Mm-hmm. And so there, it's twofold in that. So that's one of the large goals to accomplish in the next couple of years. Also, I'm getting older. I think that's the reality of it, is that, and I'm 51 now. I've probably got 11 years left in this. It's strong. I think when I get to that point of 62, I need to start phasing away and start letting someone else take over the reins. That's the reality. And that's one of the goals, that in the next 5 years that we'll start looking for a sustainability plan, but also succession plan, so that way that the organization can continue to live on far beyond when I'm gone. I'll still be active, you know. I'll visit and I'll be a good consultant, but I don't want it to die with me. Mm-hmm. I want it to continue to grow. I want it to continue to impact, and that Chosen 300 will continue to flourish. I think there's more sites that we need to open. COVID really kicked this in for a little bit, mm-hmm. but we conquered it. But I think there's things that we still want to accomplish. We still want to open up in Reading. We still want to be able to open up more sites around the region to be able to impact people's lives.
Okay. So with that being said, tell us how we can partner or donate to your organization. Tell our viewers how we can.
Absolutely. There's a lot of wonderful ways that you can donate to Chosen 300. First of all, you can give online, chosen300.org. You can give with a credit card, Visa, MasterCard, American Express, Discover. But then also we have Cash App. A Cash App is a wonderful opportunity for a lot of millennials and people who just want to have it come out of their debit card and not go into debt. And one of the things I'll say is about giving with a credit card is that you should never give a gift that you can't pay off at the end of the month. A lot of organizations will say, just, oh, give $10,000 on your credit card.
Right.
Well, and you make $1,000 a month. No. You give what you can afford to pay on your credit card that you can pay. Use a credit card as an avenue of convenience, not as an avenue to get into debt. And that's important for people to hear, because a lot of organizations will try to just get what they can but not care about the person that's giving. And that's very important to us. So you can give in that avenue. If you have United Way in your job, you can give through United Way. If you're a federal employee, you can give through the combined federal campaign. And if you're a city of Philadelphia employee, you can give through the city campaign. And so all those avenues, and it's the old-fashioned way too. You can also give a check in the mail. And that address is P.O. Box 95, Ardmore, Pennsylvania, 19003. So those are opportunities to give as far as that direction. We also encourage people that have stock. I mean, they can give with stocks and securities. And the advantage of giving with stocks and securities is that when you give a stock or a security in kind, you can avoid the capital gains tax, but you can also write off the value of that. So it's almost like a double benefit there. People give life insurance, where if they have a life insurance policy, maybe your children are grown now, they have their own businesses, they're successful, and then it really don't need to depend on your life insurance benefit. Mm-hmm. If you change the ownership and the beneficiary to Chosen 300 and then live out your life insurance, and when you pass away, the proceeds would come to Chosen 300, but at that point you can write off the cash value. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people don't know a lot of these tools that you can use for giving, but those are wonderful opportunities. As individuals, not only just giving your resource and your money, but also give your time and your effort. Yeah. And so by coming and volunteering, you can go on our website, you can click on volunteer hours, you can show up anytime. But also maybe you're a church or a small group and you say, you know what, I want to sponsor a night. For our West Philadelphia and Pottstown sites, it's $300 per meal. In Center City, it's about $600 a meal. And that's not money that you would give to us. That's money that you would give to your team to purchase the food, to prepare it, and bring it in. Some churches and groups come once a month. Some come once every other month. Some come three times a year. And then there's also opportunities for meal sponsorship. Those same figures, $300 for here in West Philadelphia. I mean, West Philadelphia and Spring Garden. West Philadelphia and Pottstown, and then Spring Garden is $600. Sometimes it's so many sites I get tangled up sometimes too. But again, if you like to sponsor a night, you can say that, okay, I want to sponsor a night. I want to bring my family down and serve. Here's a check. We'll prepare all the food and get it ready for you. And those are wonderful opportunities. We've had people also do what's called Celebrate. Okay. Celebrate is a thing that we have on our website where you can pick a day and say, I want to celebrate my birthday. I'm bringing everybody down, and I want y'all to come and serve the homeless for my birthday, and we will send y'all a PayPal link that's designated for your birthday, and you can send it to all your friends, and then raise the money for that particular night, and then come and serve. I've had a lady very recently call me. Her sister passed away, and who used to volunteer at Chosen 300. She says, listen, I just want people, instead of giving flowers, to give to Chosen 300. Can you help us do that? And she actually took a QR code and put it on the obituary. And I was just amazed by that. You know, I kind of said it very subtle, but on the same token, it was a wonderful way for her to celebrate her sister. There's another gentleman whose son was killed a few years ago, and he comes and does a meal in honor of his son every year. You can, that pastor's anniversary, instead of having a pastor anniversary service at your church, say, you know what, let's celebrate our pastor by letting us all serve together in his honor. There are so many ways that you can give up your time, your energy, your service, and your resource to make Chosen 300 be what it is and be what it can be. And help us be the hands and feet of Jesus as we impact people's lives here and around the world.
Wow. This is just beautiful. I'm filled up right now, because this is just, I know some of the story, but just being here and talking to you and finding out more, it's a lot, but it's beautiful. And something else you did not mention, though, you have like yearly fundraisers. I know it's something with the ice bucket challenge?
So there's a couple of things that people can get involved with during the course of the year. The next one coming up is New Year's Day.
Okay.
We're jumping into freezing cold water at Branchwood Park. I've done it six times now. Matter of fact, 1 year was 4 degrees out, and we had to dig through 6 inches of ice in order to be able to jump in the water. And it's a wonderful opportunity. And if you can't be there in person, you can do the ice bucket challenge. You simply go outside, get an ice bucket, you know, have one of your family members dunk you. But the key is to raise money. And if you tell somebody that I'm going to jump in freezing cold water, or I'm going to do ice bucket challenge for Chosen 300, they will give you money just to see you do it. And so that's a wonderful opportunity to be able to raise money for the mission. We have a walk against homelessness in April, or actually in June. That's a wonderful opportunity. But all throughout the year, there's different things that we do for you to be able to give and support the mission. December is critical. But all throughout the year is important to be able to help those in need.
So are you serving dinner here for Christmas?
So Christmas Day, we are here in the morning, actually.
Okay.
We have brunch both here and in Spring Garden. And one of the things that people can do is that, one, they can bring toys for the children that are here. We get an abundance of children on Christmas Day, and we try to plaster them.
Okay.
And so if you want to wrap your gift, you can wrap your gift, just indicate the age and the gender.
Okay.
Or if you want to bring it unwrapped, we have a whole team of folks that will be wrapping gifts and getting things ready. But Christmas is big around here.
Okay.
And all of our staff gives up their time on Christmas Day. And for the last, I guess now it's been about 20 years that Christmas Day it has been open. And so we'll be here and in Center City. Christmas Eve will be open in Pottstown too. So there's plenty of opportunities there.
Okay. So just before we go, give us your social media handles, your websites.
I love when people ask me that. If you Google Chosen 300,
you're there.
You know what? It's like I said, I'm 51 years old now.
Okay.
And so we have staff for that. Okay. So, but I do know we have a Chosen 300 Facebook page. Look for the one that just says Chosen 300. There's a couple extra pages out there, but the one that says just Chosen 300, that's for Facebook. I know we're on Instagram. I know we're on all that stuff. Important, go to our website, chosen300.org, and you can pull up all that information. I am not the geeky person here, and okay. So we work as a team.
Right.
All of us contribute what we can, and that's not my contribution. I can go on my own Facebook page and talk,
right,
and then forward to them, and then they share it out. I don't know what I'm doing.
Well, we know that we can find you in the West Philly campus, which is, tell us the address.
Yeah, so here it's at 3959 Lancaster Avenue. It's right at the corner of 40th and Lancaster. Okay. And, you know, an exciting thing about this site, what a lot of people don't know, is that in 1965, Dr. Martin Luther King actually spoke in this corner as part of the Freedom Tour, and 10,000 people were actually on this corner. And when you look at the video, this building is actually in the background. So it's exciting. So, and then our other locations, 1116 Spring Garden Street, and then 150 North Hanover Street in Pottstown. So any of those locations, you're welcome to volunteer regionally. If you want to do some globally, we're actually going to South Africa for February 1st through the 13th. So anybody wants to jump on that trip, you can go on our website, click on the South African flag. Your application will come up, and it'll be a wonderful opportunity to be able to go to places like Pretoria or Soweto and stand in Nelson Mandela's house, and also missions in Cape Town, and you'll be able to say,
"What does that mean?"
That means the name of the Lord is to be praised.
Wow, beautiful, beautiful. Well, Brian, I thank you so much for just taking time out, because I know you're busy, to just talk to us. We're so encouraged, and we just would like for you to offer a word of prayer to our viewers.
Absolutely. Lord, we love you, and we thank you, God, for your goodness and your mercy, your son Jesus, our great redeemer. We thank you, God, for all the folks that are listening today. We pray that you would bless them, but also touch their hearts to have a desire to give, to work, and to serve those in need. We pray, God, that the blessings of God would overshadow them, and that you would keep them in their journey. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. That's our show, and with God, all things are possible. Be blessed.
If you work your grace, the grace will work for you. Company, teach the lesson.